very nice conference. Well, I was going to
thank for the opportunity as a young researcher to speak here, but I'm not sure that I really should thank the organization, because talk after the attendees is really, really a great challenge. So what I can say is that I'll do my best. That's the only thing that I can promise. So today I'm going to talk about some. My talk will be based in a work with José Alves from the University of Porto. Everyone can hear me? I would like not to use the microphone. Okay, thanks. And Vanessa Ramos from the University of Maranhão in Brazil. So, let's start very general. We will consider a dynamical system, just simple map on a compact vector space. Okay. So we know that we can choose an invariant measure to analyze your system. But we know that when you have this setting of continuous map on a compact map space, you always have invariant measures. More than this, you have plenty of invariant measures. Because for instance, you can construct a measure supported in a period of, and we know that for chaotic dynamical systems, there are plenty of periodic orbs. Okay? So a question is, how to choose a measure, an invariant measure, to analyze your dynamical system? That's a question that may be answered in different ways. For instance, during this conference, we saw talks on SRB measures, or I'm going to talk today about equilibrium states. The good choice today for an invariant measure will be an equilibrium state. We introduce another element to your, to our dynamics, which is just observable, which is a continuous function on your metric space. I'll call it potential. And now we are interested in understand the dynamical system of this pair, a map and a potential. Okay? So formally, let us formalize this concept. An equilibrium state is an invariant measure under F such that maximizes this quantity, the entropy of the map plus the integral of the potential under all invariant measures. We know from the variational principle that this quantity is maximized, sorry, that the topological pressure of the map F and the potential phi can be maximized by the, can be computed by this supremo, the entropy plus the integral. Okay? So, going back to the definition, we can think of an equilibrium state as an invariant measure that that I can compute the topological pressure simply by computing the entropy of the map plus the integral of the potential. Okay? Well, the first question that you should make to yourself is, which conditions can I put on the map and on the potential to the existence of equilibrium states? Or more than this, to finiteness of equilibrium states and even more uniqueness. This has been studied since the 70s and started with very nice work from Bowen, Sinai, Well, and Walters, where we can summarize saying that they use that for a map that's uniformly expanding and a potential that's called continuous, it admits a unique equilibrium state. After that, many people have worked on this field, and I don't want to exhaust the list here. I'm sure that, as Ali mentioned in his talk this week, I'm sure that there are more people hitting this list. I would like to say that for partial hyperbolic maps, it's still very far from being well understood. We have a few works. I may have given you the impression that there are lots of work here, but it's not true. Here it's a few work in this setting. And it's quite far from being well understood, and I have myself dedicated a lot of time on this. And I'm still dedicating to it. But once you get bored or starting all your talks with uniqueness of equilibrium state, it's time to ask other questions. And today we are going to answer a different question, not about uniqueness, but the following question. Suppose you are in one of these sets that you already know about the uniqueness. You can say that there is a unique equilibrium state for some set. So how can you say the following? Well, under which conditions do these equilibrium states depend continuously on the dynamics and or on the potential? So my title was equilibrium stability. We'll say that when these equilibrium states depend continuously, jointly, on the dynamics and on the potential, that this family of maps and potentials are stable, are equilibrium stable. Let us formalize this concept. So we start with a compact Riemann manifold, and then we consider F just a family of C1 local difeomorphism. And we go with the natural topology, the C1 topology. And then you consider C alpha, the space of Hölder continuous potentials. And we go with also the natural norm, the C alpha norm. Then we consider the product, F times C alpha, and with the product topology. And now we suppose that there exists a family or a subset of this product for which every pair in this family admit a unique equilibrium state. This I know a priori. So we say that this family is equilibrium stable if the function that associates a pair in the family to the equilibrium state, the unique equilibrium state, is continuous. Here I should make some questions, some comments. When we start with this concept, we want to give a bit more general concept. We could just call it continuity of the equilibrium state. But we want to, this concept is called equilibrium stable because of the following. We could think that H is a family that admit finite equilibrium states. Not necessarily a unique equilibrium state, but it's fair. Okay, finite. And then you consider a sequence in this family. Each pair has a finite number. Let's say that you choose one equilibrium state for each pair. Let's say that it's called mu n, an equilibrium state. Then we would like to say that this family H is equilibrium stable if every sequence that converts to some pair F5 in H, the sequence that I associate could be a different sequence because now I have a finite number of equilibrium states. So for this, converts or has a correlation point on a mu that is an equilibrium state for the limit. Okay. Our work, mostly, I will make it clear soon, mostly work for this setting. But we needed a bit ugly and technical condition that leads for the uniqueness in the setting that I'll describe later. And then we end up with this definition. But in our paper, we use this more general definition. Okay? So I'll start choosing a setting H, a subset H, that's more simple. So let's start with uniform expanding maps, just the natural concept, okay? Then we consider E, the set of all your C1 uniform expanding maps. We know from Bowen that each pair in E times C alpha, well, it means that the map is uniformly expanding, and the potential is order continuous, each pair admit a unique equilibrium state. So inside of our concept. What we prove is that the families, this family is actually equilibrium state. What does it mean? I will recall in this slide the definition. Equilibrium state means that each time that I associate a pair in H, the function that associates it to its unique equilibrium state is continuous.
This should be C1 plus F. The derivative should be another continuous or is there for C1?
C1.
The potential is alpha.
Yes. The potential has to be C alpha. But the map just C1.
Stability is in the weak star topology?
In weak star topology. Okay, so we believe that this result is somewhat folklore, but we didn't find anywhere in the literature. But our goal is a bit more general setting, the following that I'm going to explain now. So consider sigma CF, C is a constant fix, as the set of non-uniformly expanding points. It is the points that satisfy this mean two. Okay? Well, we lose a bit now the regularity on the map. Now we have to ask a bit more for the potential. So we consider hyperbolic potentials. Well, I just learned last week in a talk of Felix, a Polish name that I'm sorry I cannot pronounce, that there is another. Thank you very much. So there is another concept of hyperbolic potential. This one was introduced by Viana and Marcel Viana and Vanessa Ramos. I'm not sure if they knew about this other concept, but if you know the other concept, I thought just a bit, but I think it's not equivalent. So let's, for today, stick with this one that I'm going to explain now. So we will say that a potential, just continues a priori, is a hyperbolic potential if the topological pressure is concentrated in the set of non-uniformly expanding points. What do I mean by this? I mean that the topological pressure of the map F with respect to the potential phi relative to the set of uniformly expanding points has to be strictly greater than the topological pressure of its complement. Okay? By Pesin theory, we know that this inequality implies this equality, because the topological pressure can be computed as the supremum between, the maximum between this and this. So since this is strictly greater, it has to be equal to the topological pressure. So that's what I mean, that it's the topological pressure. Basically, the potential is not seeing the complement of this set. Okay? It concentrates all the topological pressure in the good set, in non-uniform expanding points. So this is a good class. We proved with Zelms and Vanessa Ramos that this form an open class. So it's a good class to consider. So let's take our setting. We start with HC, which are the set of all pairs. F is just a C1 diffeomorphism, and phi is a Hodel continuous potential that's hyperbolic for F. So I alternate F with phi with F. And then I add another hypothesis. HC star is HC with this extra hypothesis that says that all the pre-ops are dense in N for each point. Okay? I will tell you later why I need this. I actually don't need exactly this hypothesis. But this is nice to write and can be also simple to check. For instance, if the map is strongly uniformly mixing, what I mean by this is that for each open set, U, there exists an iterate that covers the whole space. This we call it strongly mixing. So if this property, you can obtain this property, for instance. This is a bit weaker. But we need even weaker than this, I'll let you know later. So our main tip, Vanessa Holmes and Marcelo Viana, they proved that for a pair in HC, you have a finite number of ergodic equilibrium states. And if you add this condition, so you have uniqueness. What we proved is that in this family with the extra condition, we have that this family is equilibrium stable. Recall that this means that the function that associates a pair in HC star to an equilibrium state, to the unique equilibrium state, is continuous. Okay? The weak star topology. I will keep here HC so you can recall. With the extra condition. So my goal is to give you the main characters on the proof of this main theorem. But before this...
So what's the symbol there? The HC star is F5 contained in what?
HC star?
Yes, is something is contained in some product.
Sorry, I will raise again the right. It's F times C alpha. It's F times C alpha. I'm just keeping this for future.
But on the screen you have something else. On the screen it's written.
Yes. I would like to put together because I have this and this. I would like just to write this. But here I need the HC, so I was putting all together in the one notation. Thanks. F times C alpha plus, I write informally here, okay? Plus F minus.
But also plus C hyperbolic. Plus C hyperbolic.
Of course, this is quite important. Very important. Plus F C hyperbolic. I cannot do anything without this condition. Thanks. So, all right. I just want to keep this so. You can remember the main theorem. I should have written nicely, sorry. But first, before we go to the proof, let's give an example that applies to our main theorem. I will describe a HC family that applies to the theorem. We start with a map that's local diffeomorphism as before, and then we consider the following. We consider a region B that's a bad set. B stands for bad. Why? I allow some both. Well, sorry. I have expansion outside of B, so that's what H2 says. I have a uniform expansion, but inside of B, I allow some contraction. Okay? B is a bad set. So in B, I allow some contraction, but outside of B, I have expansion, uniform expansion. So this, I simplify this model here, but in a bit more detail, it was studied by Trelle Oliveira and Marcelo Viana in another work, Paulo Varandas and Marcelo Viana, and they proved that for this example and for holder continuous potentials with small variation. By small variation, I understand that the supremum minus the infimum is smaller than a constant. That's just depending on f. So if you have these, a map like this, and the potential with small variation, then for these works, you can say that there exists a unique equilibrium state. So that was the work. But you can go to the proof and extract the following result that I stated here. There exists a sheaf such that for any holder potential, it's hyperbolic with respect to f. Okay? Because that's what I need. I need a map and I need a hyperbolic potential. It's not directly from their work, they were not their goal, but we can extract from the proof. Okay? Then we consider f, the C1 local diffeomorphism that satisfies H1 and H2. And H is the pair in f and potential holder continuous with small variation. We know that H has unique equilibrium state for their work, and we know that the potential is hyperbolic with respect to f. So then, for our main theorem, this family is equilibrium stable. It is, this function is continuous. Okay? So that's one example to our result. Let's move to the elements of the proof. How much time do I have, please? I think I have
25 minutes.
Great, thanks. The first main character is the transfer operator. So for each pair in HC star, remember HC star is phi hyperbolic and dot dense. Phi hyperbolic, sorry. I've been telling phi all the time. Phi. Phi stands by phi, for phi. Yes. So we consider the following operator defined on the space of continuous functions on N. So we consider the whole sum on the pre-images of the map F, and then we sum exponential of the potential and multiply by the observable where I'm applying the operator. That's the classical definition. This operator has good properties. In this setting, for instance, it's a bounded operator and it's positive. So we can compute the spectral radius simply by taking this limit of the norm of the iterates to the power 1 over n. You can think of the definition of the spectral radius as this if you don't remember. And the iterates of this operator also has a good property. It's not hard to compute that the iterates will appear here on the exponential, the big of sum, and on the sum, you start to sum over all the n pre-images of the map F. And now, just looking for these iterates, you can feel a bit the hypothesis. For instance, you ask for holder continuous potentials. Well, we would like to control the big of sums. Holder would be a good property. You also ask for some kind of expanding behavior, at least non-uniform expanding behavior. So here appear the pre-images. If you have expanding behavior, for the pre-images you have a contractive behavior. So if you want to make this thing go to some limit, the expanding behavior will be good. Not a proof, of course, it's just a feeling of what we need. The operator is defined on the space of continuous function, but by his Markov theorem, you can think of the dual of this operator in the space of probability measures on N. And moreover, you can think of this quality as a definition of the dual operator. So you can either compute the integral of an observable like this using the dual or using the operator itself. And the key lemma that we proved is the following. Each pair in the HC star admit the following. There exists a I target measure associated to the dual operator. And the eigenvalue is exactly the spectral radius. Moreover, we have that the spectral radius is the only real eigenvalue for the dual operator that is in this interval. If you are used with the formal thermodynamics, you know that spectral gap property is a good property to obtain limit theorems or other properties. This is not a gap spectral gap property. We think of it as a pre-spectral gap property because you can separate this eigenvalue from the rest. Okay? But it's not a spectral gap property yet. I'll tell a bit of it in the end of the talk. So that's the key lemma that we prove. And to prove it, we actually use this concept that was talked before this week, hyperbolic times. If you remember the talk of Newton, he talked about free time, but mentioned that it's related to the hyperbolic times. So hyperbolic time is a natural n, and it's associated to a certain point x. It satisfies the derivative satisfies this inequality. Well, let's forget about the definition and think about the properties that was proved by José Alves, Christian Bonatti, and Marcel Viana that say the following. I will draw exactly the same draw that Newton made this week. So, but for hyperbolic points.
So can I ask a question about the previous slide?
Of course.
You mentioned this pre-spectral gap.
It's just a name. It's not a...
But when you say it's the only real eigenvalue satisfied, you mean that it's simple? Or you just...
It's simple.
You know that it's simple.
Okay. We know this. Okay. It's simple. Okay? But just this that we know. Okay. We don't know about the rest of this paper. All right, so I was talking about the good property that hyperbolic times satisfy due to this work. So I'll try to explain this test in a picture. If you have n as a hyperbolic time for x, then you think of the following. You look at the orb of x up to time n, and there exists a delta, positive, it's a universal constant in the sense that this delta just depends on f and on the c that we fix. And then, if n is a hyperbolic time for x, there exists a ball of radius delta that is sent diffeomorphically and contractively for the other points in the orb through the inverse branch. So I take this ball, this is a small ball of radius delta around fnx, and this is sent contractively, the smaller ball here, by the inverse branch of f. And then I send the other also convectively by the second branch, and so on, up to x. As Newton mentioned, there is not that you can say from this point to this point or here. These we don't say anything. But just the blue are giving me contraction through fn to the back until x. Okay? So that's what we say in this lemma. What we prove is that in the set that we are considering, the set of non-uniformly expanding points, there are plenty of hyperbolic times. Each point here has infinitely many hyperbolic times. More than this, there is some frequency that we need to consider, but just a bit informally, there are plenty of hyperbolic times in this good set. Then, we prove the following proposition. If you have an eigenmeasure Remember that there is at least one. We prove it as the key lemma. So if you have an eigenmeasure, any eigenmeasure for the dual operator, the support of this measure has to be total. Has to be actually the whole space. Well, this is because this extra condition that we put. It implies this. What we would like actually is that the support of an eigenmeasure contains this set. Because in this set I have plenty of hyperbolic times and I can do some computations. But if we add this condition, then we get that the support is total. The whole space N. We don't need actually this, but okay, that's what we get. And by adding this condition, we also get uniqueness. So if you change this condition for the support of mu is contain this set sigma, then we are fine. But this is not a beautiful, elegant condition, so I thought that this was nice. Moreover, what we prove? We prove that for hyperbolic times, balls, dynamical balls of length hyperbolic times has a good property. It's a type, it's a Gibbs property type. Let's formalize. The measure of a hyperbolic, sorry, let me rephrase. The measure of a dynamic ball whose length is a hyperbolic time can be compared to the exponential of a big constant for one point in this ball minus n times the log of the spectral radius. Okay? This is a kind of a Gibbs property. But here we just have four balls whose length is hyperbolic time. A corollary of this proposition is that you can compute the topological pressure as the log of the spectral radius. This is very useful because what we'll do is the following. We'll prove that the spectral radius is continuous. Then we prove immediately that the topological pressure is continuous. And then it's crucial to prove that the equilibrium state is continuous and therefore is equilibrium stable. Okay? So, first we prove the following. We restrict our operator for the space of a Hodler continuous function. So we start defining the operator L, the transfer operator, in the space of all continuous functions, continuous observables. But now we stick to the space of Hodler continuous. And we prove that this map is continuous. Well, we don't need this continuous, we just need the following result. A weaker pointwise convergence. That when I choose an observable folder continuous and I look for the sequence of operators evaluating this observable, then this converts to the sequence of the limit evaluated in the same observable. Okay? This is weaker, we don't need this, but what we prove is this is a bit stronger result. Then we want to prove the continuity of the topological pressure. How do we do this? Well, let's start by considering a sequence of pairs Fn, phi n in Hc star, converting to some pair fixed F phi. Okay, so then, let's call lambda n the spectral rays associated to this pair, and lambda the spectral rays associated to the limit. So we prove that lambda n converts to lambda using this convergence. Recall that the spectral rate is given by the iterates of the transfer operator, limit of a norm of the iterates of the transfer operator. So with this convergence, we obtain this convergence. So from this, it's immediate that the topological pressure is continuous. Because the topological pressure, as I mentioned two slides before, it's just log of lambda. Okay? So let's do some steps of the proof. Now we are prepared for this. We have a sequence of pairs Fn, phi n in Hc star that are converging to S phi. And we consider mu n the equilibrium state associated to these pairs. So we want to prove that each accumulation point of this sequence is an equilibrium state. There is a unique equilibrium state in this set. So if an accumulation point is an equilibrium state, it has to be this delimited. So first we have to prove that any accumulation point is invariant under F. Then we prove that there exists a generating partition. This comes from the hyperbolic types. This delta is enough to guarantee a construction of a generating partition. And from this, we can have this inequality. The limsup of the entropies has to be smaller than than the limits, than the accumulation point entropy. Well, that is because the generating partition is the same for all the maps here. Okay? So, since we can make at the same generating partition, we obtain, has to be a bit of work, but we obtain these inequalities. And then, well, the topological pressure is continuous. So this is the limit of the topological pressure of the pairs converging to F5. But then, by the variational principle, the topological pressure can be computed as the entropy plus the integral. We call that mu n is an equilibrium state. But from this inequality, I can change this to this. And by the definition, by the topological variational principle, the topological pressure has to be bigger than this sum. So then it's equal, and therefore by definition, mu zero is an equilibrium state. So any accumulation point is in fact an equilibrium state for the limit. And therefore, this function is continuous, okay? Well, we can push a bit more further the result for a class of a skew product. How much time do I have now?
About 10 minutes, I think.
If about...
I didn't get it to be sincere.
I think it's 13 minutes.
13, okay. Yes. Okay, so we can push a bit farther the results for a class of skew products. What we consider is the following. In the base, we put an uniform expanding map. And in the fiber, we put a contraction. For a hyperbolic potential, now I consider the following. Well, if I put a contraction, it's in a simpler way written, not so formal here. But if I put a contraction on the fiber, the topological pressure will be given by the base, okay? Because I have just a contraction in the fiber. So I define now hyperbolic potential as the pressure being concentrated in the set of non-uniformly expanding points times the whole fiber n. Okay? And for this, we prove, again together with Zelvis and Vanessa Hammers, we prove uniqueness of the equilibrium state. If the base is transitive, it's not has finite number of equilibrium states. Continuity of the topological pressure, and we prove that the equilibrium states are stable. So this function also varies continuously. Why do we want to study this kind of skew products? We want to go further for partially hyperbolic systems. So this one is not the best one example, but at least we have another class of example given by these kind of skew products. We can include here for instance, the partially hyperbolic horseshoe defined by Diaz, Rios, somebody, and Dorita. Isabel is looking at me not in a nice way. it's a class of partially hyperbolic systems introduced by them. And for this class, if you know it, I'm not going to enter on it. I have been talking about this class for a long time. But if you know it, this is inside of this example. So you can include this class of partially hyperbolic horseshoes in these two products. Further questions would be the following. We talked about continuity of equilibrium states when you vary together F and phi. You could ask other kind of questions, and this, using the words of Ali, it's quite hot now, this problem, to study the following. You can vary just a potential and study the regularity of topological entropy, equilibrium state, or maximal entropy measured, and then you vary just the map and the study. Well, I have to mention that there are a group here in Bahia that has worked on it. It's a big paper, nice, and from Thiago Bonfim, Armando Castro, and Paulo Parandas, where they studied a class of non-uniform expanding maps. If you recall the example, the first example that I gave, I put it in a very simplified way, but they studied something similar to this example, and they proved that when you vary the potential, you have analysis for the transfer operator, you have analysis for the reference measure, and then they also vary just the dynamics, and they prove, which is a bit very nice actually, they prove the differentiability for the maximal entropy measure, correct? Okay, so inspired by this work, I've been now worked for a long time in a project with Suzette Afonso and Vanessa Ramos, and we have almost finished to study the same kind of problems, but for the setting that I present today for you, for non-uniform expanding maps, for this setting, non-uniform expanding maps and hyperbolic potentials. So I hope it will be soon out, and then you can see. I guess that's what I want to talk. Thank you. Some ideas we can think together. Can be good. Yeah. I don't know any. Do you know any? No, I don't think I know any result with this. For this kind of regularity, I don't think.
It is for the Yana map.
If for what?
Yana map.
Well, for the Yana maps, there are very new results that I have to confess that I didn't finish reading. From Clement Hagen, Thompson, and I may have forgotten someone, Mike Todd, or Todd Fisher, sorry, please don't record. And but they don't study the regularity, the uniqueness of equilibrium state. I don't think that they study the regularity.
It's for Bonatti, Vienna example, not for the ones that you have pretty good ones.
Ah, okay, so no. So the answer is no, according to Paulo Parandas, the answer is no, not yet. There is not results with critical points yet. Okay.
Any questions?
I have just a question that in the first setting of expanding maps, Thiago and Armando, they have been also in the response for the class of
for
other
uniform
formulas. uniformly expanded this way.
But not for jointly.
Jointly? Yeah.
Okay. So I can make an experiment.
It's recent. Yeah.
Ah, okay. Okay. So I was not aware of it. Thanks. I'll make an next time.
So in critical points, there's a several results about the continuity of absolutely continuous invariant measures. Because in towers, so presumably you should be able to generalize those results.
Yes. My next goal in life is to really understand the towers, because it's very beautiful work. Actually, I should mention that I attended the talk of Lai Sang-yuan last week in ICM, and was so inspired and so great that I'm excited to learn this and maybe change the approach. So I think it's a good suggestion. Thank you. Next conference. Okay.
Well, thank you again.
Maybe a short announcement is that after